Isn't it incredible that a gospel opportunity can fit in your hands? It's called an Operation Christmas Child shoebox, and it's filled with fun toys, hygiene items, school supplies, and a personal message. But really, it's much more than that. It's a tangible expression of God's love to introduce Jesus Christ. Churches just like this, when they pack shoeboxes, have a significant gospel impact around the world.
In the beginning, people from this village, they were hard-hearted to receive the gospel. The turning point was when we distributed gift boxes. I saw a great impact. After the distribution, many of children gave their life to Jesus and started with the greatest journey. The greatest journey is so impactful because it's the word of God. I've seen Jesus putting hope upon the children. God is doing a great work.
If you want something as a pastor where your people can get involved in ministry, something that has maximum impact in the worldwide kingdom of Christ, I mean, what better thing could you do than be involved in Operation Christmas Child? To me, it's a no-brainer.
I have seen firsthand how a shoebox is an opportunity and a tool that opens the door to share the gospel of Jesus Christ.
These boxes open kids' hearts to the fact that there's people all over the world that love them, and what it shows them ultimately is that there's a God that loves them.
This is one of many shoebox distributions we've been doing on the nation of Kiribati.
We have brought tens of thousands of shoebox gifts. And even though it's August, it's Christmas for these children.
Scripture tells us, go throughout all ends of the earth and bring the good news of Jesus Christ to make fishers of men. That's what we've been called to do. And that's what I love about Operation Christmas Child. It knows no borders and knows no boundaries. It's all about sharing the name of Jesus Christ.
Each year, around 11 million gospel opportunities are shared in over 120 countries. And more than 4 million children enroll in the greatest journey and learn to be disciples. The gospel is truly going to the ends of the earth. Your local church is having a massive impact, all because of the simple act of packing a shoebox. These shoebox gifts create an opportunity for entire congregations to fulfill the Great Commission. With every shoebox you pack, your church is empowering and training churches globally to share the gospel. This is truly the Great Commission in action.
It got awful quiet all of a sudden, didn't it? Everybody's going to know what's going to happen next. we've made it to Thanksgiving weekend. Isn't that amazing? We're going to have time to gather together with loved ones and friends. Despite what they're telling us, we're going to go and see people. I'm going to go hold some grandkids. You do whatever you want to do. I'm going to go hold some grandkids. You know, Pastor Appreciation, you loved on us as a staff, and you gave us a gift, gave me a gift to put a stereo on an old 94 Jeep. Well, I have a problem. I had a problem. I already bought the stereo and the speakers, and no one wanted to put it in because I didn't buy it from them. So I took it over to Not Handyman Service, and I have a stereo in a 94 Jeep. And my goodness, music, music, music. And hands-free calling. Can you believe that? I called my wife and said, hey, I'm in my Jeep. She says, I can tell. And but anyway, I thank you. But you know, it's not about the thing. It's not about the stereo. But every time I hear music, I want to think of you. You know, that's what it counts. Paul said, I give thanks always in remembrance of you. Boy, Thanksgiving special. And I just want to say thank you. And I want to tell you how much I love you as a family of God. And so I want you to be thinking, what are you thankful for? God so loved us, he gave his son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Man, that's worthy to be thankful of. So as we go before the Lord in prayer, just think in your mind, what are you thankful for? And then also, what are you thankful for before the Lord in that everlasting life? Let's lift up our hearts before him. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you. Father, we know that we have things. We have possessions. We gather stuff around us. But Father, that's not what counts. To be held in your hand, to have eternal life, be called your child. Oh, Father, we thank you. We give thanks with everything within us for your love upon us. And then, Father, you have graciously, it says in the Bible that Christ, the head of the church, places us into a body of Christ. And you have placed us here at Westside First Baptist Church, Father, into a family that loves each other, serves each other, and cares for each other. And so, Lord, we say thank you. Thank you for this family. Thank you for this body. And Father, we want to pray. We pray for those who do not know you. We pray for those who have not been placed into the body of Christ. Father, for those who do not understand of that graciousness that we have poured out upon us through you. So Lord, we pray for them today. As we enter into this time of worship, Father, we pray that they may come to know you as a heavenly Father, that Father, you will draw them to yourself, that your Holy Spirit will enter in and give understanding of word and convict, and then Father, draw them, that they too may know Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior. And Father, we come and we thank you for our pastor, Brother Doug. Father, you have called him and you placed him here as the shepherd. And so we, as your children, thank you. We pray over him and his family. We pray, Father, that today as he comes behind this holy desk, that, Father, he opens the word of God and he preaches, that, Father, we will hear your word through him. Father, a word that you have prepared for our hearts, our minds, and, Father, for our soul. Oh, Father, may we hear. May we be changed. May we be obedient. So, Lord, we lift up joyful voices. We lift up joyful song. We lift up hearts and hands before you in gratitude, in love, and in thanksgiving. And it's in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, that we lift this up. Amen.
Let's stand together today and sing "The House of the Lord."
We worship the God who was. We worship the God who is. We worship the God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors. He parted the raging sea. My God, he holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. Shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. 'Cause he hung upon that cross. Then he rose up from that grave. My God, still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We were the beggars, Now we're royalty. We were the prisoners. Now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. We were the beggars. Now we're royalty. We were the prisoners. Now we're running free. We are forgiven, accepted, redeemed by His grace. Let the house of the Lord sing praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. We shout out Your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place. We won't be quiet. We shout out Your praise.
Amen. You may be seated just for a moment. Just a few announcements this morning. Discipleship training tonight at 6 o'clock in Kids Choir. Again, at 6 o'clock tonight, this will be the last thing, corporate thing that we will do until after Thanksgiving, because Wednesday night, everything is canceled for that day here at the church because of the Thanksgiving holiday that is here. And Brother Roger mentioned that Thanksgiving is here. It's hard to imagine, and you think back to 2020, that we were so excited to get to 2021, and now 2021 is almost over. Almost over. Tomorrow ends the National Collection Week for Operation Christmas Child, so you still have time to get those shoeboxes packed and get them in. They've got to be turned in by 11 o'clock tomorrow, and the ladies will be here this afternoon.
We're going to be here from 1 to 6, and
they'll be here from 1 to 6. And so, guys, if you'll stay tonight right after discipleship time, we'll help load the truck. If you know what we do, we load a box truck, and then tomorrow they'll be taking that truck down to Cabot. So, guys, we need your help tonight around 7 o'clock. Celebrate Recovery is Monday night, 5:30. They'd love to have you. They meet here in the sanctuary first. Men's prayer breakfast will be happening this Tuesday at 7 a.m. at Bentley's Restaurant. Guys, if you come for the first time, we'll buy your breakfast. Now, the Joy of Living Bible Study is taking their winter break for the ladies. Guys, don't forget, we will not meet this Tuesday, but we will meet the following Tuesday. Grief Share will meet Tuesday from 2:30 to 4:30. We're manning the storehouse food pantry this Wednesday, and they do need help. They would love to have you come and help. Miss Brooke is behind me back here. You can see her or Miss Christy. I don't see Miss Christy in here. She may be serving somewhere else, but she was here. So you can see one of those two ladies and get signed up to serve. Let's see. All right, Celebrate Recovery is gathering names of people who are in need. If you know of someone who's in need of a Thanksgiving meal, if you'll let the same person, Miss Brooke behind me, or Tina Smith, who is seated right over here, if you'll let one of them know, they'll get them a Thanksgiving meal. If you're a guest with us today, we hope you feel at home here, first off, and then second off, we'd love to know that you are here to worship with us. There is a visitor card there on the bulletin that you should have received as you come in, and so we want you to fill that out. You can either leave it in the seat where you are sitting, and it'll be picked up later, or there are giving stations out in the hallways. You can slip it into those giving stations. Now, we have several who are either on the road today or about to be on the road, and then we have several who have families who are coming in to Greer's Ferry, and so we certainly want to remember those who will be traveling this week for the Thanksgiving holiday. We also have several who are at home, and they're watching online. In Arkansas in November, it's 70 degrees one day, and it's 28 degrees the next. It rains one day, and then the sun shines the next, and so there's a lot of sickness going on. And because COVID is still out there, there are several who are staying at home today just to be certain that they don't have the virus and pass it around in our church. And for that, we all say amen, right? Thank you for that. And so they're going to be joining us online. We're so honored that they're worshiping with us in that way today. Again, if you are a guest with us, we hope you feel at home here. We hope you'll come back and worship with us very, very soon. Let's pray once again. Father, once again, Lord, we just love you and praise you. We thank you for all that you've done for us. Father, we thank you so much that you sent your son Jesus to die on the cross for our sins. Now, Father, we pray that this day you would be Lord over everything that happens in this place. And Father, we are so grateful for your presence. Lord, speak to us today through song and through your word. And it's in the mighty name of Jesus we pray. Amen. At this time, children will be dismissed for children's church, ages 3-year-old through kindergarten, over to my right. Let's all stand and worship the Lord together. Brother Paul, lead us.
Give thanks. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks because He's given.
this morning. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, that you have given us the privilege to meet together to sing your praises, Lord, and then to hear your word taught this morning. Lord, I do pray that you would draw us closer to you. Lord, I do pray that you would put us, Lord, as we start looking toward the week of Thanksgiving. Lord, I pray that you would put us in this mindset, Lord, where we give thanks in all things, Father, for all that you have blessed us with. Lord, we have so much to be thankful for. I pray, Lord, that you would set our minds on you. Bless the reading and the preaching of your word and everything that is said and done today, Lord. May it bring honor and glory to you in Jesus' name. Amen. As we are looking into the week of Thanksgiving, and I don't know, it seems like when I was in school, we didn't get out a whole week for Thanksgiving. But used to be Thanksgiving Day. Now it's kind of Thanksgiving week. But I guess that's a good thing. But we are, we were talking this morning with the teenagers about things that we're thankful for and about how it's so easy to not give thanks. And kind of tried to boil down the reasons why we don't give thanks, largely to our distractions, things that keep us from setting our mind on an attitude of thankfulness and setting our mind on the things that God's blessed us with, or the darkness of the world around us, being focused on the wrong things, or my own personal struggle, which is what I told them is probably our primary one. It's just plain and simple laziness. That's me. Okay, it's not that I don't mean to give thanks, it's that I don't intentionally do it. And so it's very, very easy for us to get out of that mindset. I was looking for a song that would sort of put us in the more along the lines of thankfulness this morning. Wasn't really able to find exactly what I was looking for, but found this one that I had wanted to do for a long time, and for whatever reason I have just put it off, but I hope it'll be a blessing to you this morning. Come to the table. We all start on the outside, the outside looking in. This is where grace begins. We were hungry, we were thirsty, with nothing left to give, or the shape that we were in. Just when all hope seemed lost, love opened the door for us. He said, come to the table. Come join the sinners who have been redeemed. Take your place beside the Savior. Sit down and be set free. Come to the table. Come meet this motley crew of misfits, these liars and these thieves. There's no one unwelcome here. So that sin and shame that brought with you, you can leave it at the door and let mercy draw you near. Come to the table. Come join the sinners who have been redeemed. Take your place beside the Savior. Sit down and be set free. Come to the table. Come to the table. To the thief and to the doubter, to the hero and the coward, to the prisoner and the soldier, to the young and to the older, all who hunger, all who thirst, all the last and all the first,
All the paupers and the princes, all who fail, you've been forgiven. All who dream and all who suffer, all who loved and lost another, all the chained and all the free, all who follow, all who lead, anyone who's been let down, all the lost you have been found, all who've been labeled right or wrong, to everyone who hears this song. Oh, come to the table, come join the sinners, you have been redeemed. Take your place beside the Savior. Sit down and be set free. Oh, sit down and be set free. Come to the table. Come to the table. Sit down and be set free. Come to the table.
Amen. If you got your Bibles, go ahead and make your way to Philippians chapter 4. Philippians chapter 4. If you've been coming on Sunday mornings, you know we've been in 1 John, and we're going to take a break. Just for today, we plan to go back there next Sunday, Lord willing, but today we'll be in Philippians chapter 4. There's one line in that song that says, come meet this motley crew of misfits. That's what the church is. It's a motley crew of misfits, man. We've got liars and thieves and murderers and former homosexuals and former adulterers and former fornicators. We've got them in the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. Can you believe that we have people like that? Hey, we are the ones who have been redeemed. We sing a song that the angels cannot sing, redeemed. How I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. We can sing that. We have redemption found in Him. And if you're in this room and you know Him as Lord and Savior, you can say amen to that, right? We know Christ, and it's not because of who we are, but it's because of who He is. We are a motley crew of misfits, and it starts with the pastor in this church, I promise you that. But we are, that's who we are. What a great, great song. Brother Paul, thank you so much for that. There was a man who lived in Phoenix, Arizona, and he called his son first, over in New York. And told his son, said, I've got bad news, said, I'm breaking up with your mom. We're going to divorce. And what'd I say? Did I say something? What'd I say? Did you tell this joke in your class today? Jerry. For those of you who are not in Jerry McCarty's Sunday school class, this dad called his daughter in New York and told his daughter in New York, said, I'm done. I'm done with your mom. We're breaking up. We're going to get divorced. And so the daughter calls her brother and says, we just can't have this, and tells dad, said, we'll be on a plane tomorrow to come to your house. We're going to fix this. Don't do anything with mom until we get there. And so the dad hangs up the phone with his wife and says, for those of you who are in Jerry's class, what does she say?
You're a genius.
No. No. The dad looks at his wife and says, now it worked for Thanksgiving. What are we going to tell them for Christmas? Gosh. Jerry's got to get better at telling jokes. Stand with me on the reading of God's Word. We're going to talk today about getting ready for Thanksgiving, getting our hearts ready to go into a time of giving thanks. There are a lot of things that revolve around Thanksgiving with my family. One is football. We always watch a little football this week and this weekend. Another one is hunting. We love to hunt, and so we'll do some of that this week. It's good to have some time off to be able to do that. But above everything else, it's family. It's getting to go back home and getting with my parents and my wife's parents and grandparents and cousins and the family get-togethers. It's a great blessing to have family. But how do you get ready for Thanksgiving? Well, in Philippians chapter 4, if you look there in verse 6, the Apostle Paul says, "Don't worry about anything, but in everything, through prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses every thought, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus." Let's pray together. Father, we love you. We thank you so much for this day. Father, we pray that you would have your way in this place. And Father, that you would truly prepare our hearts for Thanksgiving week. And it's in Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Did Jerry teach out of Philippians chapter 4 as well today? Maybe we need to compare notes before Sunday. Getting ready for Thanksgiving. You know, there's a lot of things that revolve around Thanksgiving in my family. And what are some things that revolve around Thanksgiving in your family? Somebody shout them out, some things. Food. Amen. Praise God for food. What else?
Leftovers.
Those unfortunate leftovers that are left over a week after Thanksgiving, right? Anybody get sick of dressing after about Tuesday of the next week? Yeah. What else? Deer camp, football, family. All those things revolve around Thanksgiving in most of our homes. Now, I'm going to tell you, there are folks who do not have family. How sad it is for the holidays to roll around for those who do not have family. And so I want to tell you that if you're that person in this room, I want you to know I'll be praying for you this week. There are others in this church who'll be praying for you this week. Thanksgiving and Christmas, those are wonderful holidays, right? And until you lose so many in your family. And I know it can bring up those horrible memories of loss and those horrible pains of loss, but it can also bring up some great, great memories of Thanksgivings of yesterday and Christmases of yesterday. And, you know, when I sit down and think as a kid of the things that I loved about Thanksgiving, Christmas, those holiday seasons, man, such great memories of those who have gone home to heaven. And that just makes heaven sweeter, doesn't it? Makes you look forward to that day when you get to see them once again. Thanksgiving, it's a great time in which not just we as Americans, but those across this globe set aside in many nations to stop and pause and to remember what God has done for us. To remember that first Thanksgiving in the Americas where the Indians and the Pilgrims all sat down, held hands, and ate turkey, right? Didn't happen quite like that, but that's how we were taught as kids. And how many of you made the little paper pilgrim hats and the little paper pilgrim deals? I don't know if kids still do that. They do. The ones on the front, the second row there said, yeah, they do. They do. He's homeschooled, so that's why they do. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, they do at his house anyway. And I remember doing that as a kid, and I remember the things that I was taught as a kid. I grew up and read a little more about history and read that, you know, it wasn't quite like that, but there was a time of Thanksgiving for a new nation had been born. Thanksgiving. It's a wonderful, wonderful season. You know, I saw this week on Facebook, there was a big giant turkey sitting on top of a big giant Santa Claus that said, "Easy there, fat boy, Thanksgiving hasn't happened yet." How many of you have your Christmas tree up already in your house? Mine's been up for about 3 weeks. It starts before Thanksgiving. I don't know how that works, but it does in my house. And listen, it is so important that we have a time of Thanksgiving before we move into a time of Christmas. Now listen, Christmas is a beautiful holiday. It's a wonderful holiday. It's not about Santa Claus and gifts and Christmas trees. It's about our Lord and Savior being born. We know that. It's a beautiful time in the church. We have a cantata coming up. And listen, I'm telling you, don't want to miss it. It's a blessing. I've heard the cantata already, and what a beautiful, beautiful cantata it'll be in this church. This place will be full, and we'll have fellowship, and it'll be a good time. But before we get to that, we have a day this Thursday where we stop, we pause, and we give thanks for all the blessings in our lives. It's one of my favorite holidays because you don't have to spend a lot of money to have it. There's not a lot of prep work in it other than the food, ladies, I understand that. But other than that, there's not a lot of prep work in it. There's not certain clothes that had to be worn during that time. It's just a time where we come back, very laid back time, and we give thanks to God for what He has given to us. Now, getting our hearts ready as Christians for that time, number one, do not worry. That's what the Apostle Paul says in verse 6. He says, don't worry about anything. He didn't say don't worry about some things, but he says don't worry about anything. The issue in the church, in the Philippian church, was that there were a couple of ladies who couldn't agree. There were a couple of ladies who couldn't get along. This could have just as easily been two men who couldn't get along, by the way. So let's just level that playing field right off the bat. But there was an issue in the church in which two couldn't get along. And it gives the idea that there were two different camps in the church. There were two different sides. And one had taken the side of Judea, and one had taken the side of Syntyche. And they had went two separate directions. And he says that I urge these two to come together and agree in the Lord. He says, yes, I also ask you, true partner, to help these women who have contended for the gospel at my side, along with Clement and the rest of my co-workers, whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. He said, I'll say it again, rejoice. Let your graciousness be known to everyone. The Lord is near. And then he says, don't worry about anything. What has he said before he talks about this issue? He's talked about reaching forward for the goal of the great prize of heaven and of knowing the Lord Jesus Christ. He says, because of all of that, he says, don't worry about anything. There are a lot of worries and cares in this old world. Would you agree with me? There are issues that we go through. Sometimes there are financial issues that we go through. Sometimes there are physical issues that we go through in which we worry and we have anxiety about. If you are a parent in the room, you may have anxiety over the way you're raising your child. Am I doing this right? Are they going to turn out to be okay? And the answer to that is, we don't know yet. We'll find out. And the answer to that is, they're going to make mistakes. You know how I know? You did. We all do, right? So don't worry about that. Put them in God's hands. Raise them according to the Word of God and let God work in their lives. There are those maybe in this room who are worried about your spouse and your marriage. Is my marriage going to last? Going through some hard times right now. Are we going to last? The Bible says do not worry about anything. Do not have anxiety about anything. The Lord Jesus Christ said it this way, don't worry about tomorrow, because tomorrow will have enough trouble of its own. Isn't that true? The things that we worry about, you know, I read this quote that someone said, don't tell me that worry doesn't do any good. He said, I know better. The things that I worry about don't ever happen. And that's so true. As we live through life and we look back at all of the things and all of the issues that we were so concerned about, and yet God had a plan. God knows what we need before we ask for it. The word in verse 6, don't worry, don't be anxious for anything, it basically means to don't be distracted or to have a divided mind. How do we not have a divided mind? Focus on Christ. Focus on His honor and His glory for our daily lives. Every day of our lives, focusing on the Lord Jesus Christ. Jerry, I don't know if you told this one or not. If you did, they're going to laugh again. Y'all, when y'all started laughing, I thought, I just said something stupid. I don't know what I said, but I said something stupid. And no, I didn't say that stupid. Not yet. Just hang on. The young woman brought her fiancé to meet her parents for Thanksgiving dinner. He tell this one? Okay, good. After dinner, her mother told the father, said, I want you to go in. I want you to find out all you can find out about this young man. The father invited the fiancé into his study to talk for a while, and he asked, so what are your plans? The young man replied, I'm a biblical scholar. A biblical scholar, the father said. He said, well, that's admirable, but What will you do to provide a nice house for my daughter to live in? I'll study, the young man replied, and God will provide for us. How will you buy her a beautiful engagement ring that she deserves? The father asked. I'll concentrate on my studies, the young man says. God will provide for us. And children, the father asked, how will you support my grandchildren? Don't worry, sir. God will provide. Conversation was over. Everything was kind of done. The daughter goes off with the fiance, and they drive away. And husband and wife get into the bedroom that night. He said, well, she says, how did the conversation go? And the husband says, well, the conversation went okay, but I did find this out. This young man has no job plans, and for whatever reason, he thinks my name is God. Don't worry. How many of you, when you were young and you were about to get married, did someone say, it'll never last? Anybody have that in their life? Yeah. How many years some of y'all been married? I've been married for 21 years. 37? Somebody else? 60. Holy cow. It lasted, right? It lasted. Why? Don't worry about it. Let God sort it out. Let God handle the issues of life. Let God be in control. Let God have His way. Billy Graham said once that when worry is present, trust cannot crowd its way in. We've got too much worry and anxiety in our lives to let the trust of God crowd its way into our daily lives. Man, when it comes time to prepare your heart for Thanksgiving, you've got to know and understand that God's got this. I don't know what the issue is in your life, but I know this, God's got it fully under control if you're trusting Him. The Bible says that the steps of a righteous man are straight. God will make a way. God will provide. God will give you exactly what you need, sometimes not early, but it will be on time. Do not worry. Point number two is this, do pray. Do pray. He says, don't worry about anything, but in everything through prayer and petition or supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. When we do away with anxiety, when we do away with those issues that move us, that divide us, that separate us from the common goal of trusting Jesus Christ, then we are to not just sit still and do nothing. We are to go to a holy God and pray. Go to Him. Speak with Him. The past two Sunday nights in my discipleship study, we've been talking about prayer. We've been talking about those quiet moments with God, that we should spend time with our mouths shut and our hearts open before a holy God. Let Him speak. Let Him give us the peace that passes all understanding in that moment. Let Him have His way. But there are times where we go to Him and say, Lord, this is what I need. This is where I'm at. This is my great need in this hour. But we do it with thanksgiving. How do you do it with thanksgiving? Thanking Him that we know that He will have His way. He will have His will. And He is fully in charge. Spurgeon once said that as artists give themselves to their models and poets, to their classical pursuits, so must we addict ourselves to prayer. The church in 2021 is in bad shape because the people of the church of God are not praying to the God of the church. Lost folks are not being saved because we're not praying for lost folks to be saved. Saved folks are not living for Christ because we're not praying for our brothers and sisters in Christ as we should. We are not praying people in the church in 2021. You say, well, I am. Well, you are an exception. You are not the rule. We should all be in prayer. We should all be going before the Lord Jesus Christ and begging Him to move, not just in our church, but in our lives every day. Not just praying, but the right type of prayer. The Bible nowhere says that just any kind of praying will bring peace to our hearts, but it's the right type of praying. What do I mean by the right type of praying? He says to through prayer and petition or supplication with thanksgiving. Petition, going before Him, asking Him for those things that you need, asking Him to move and your own life, asking Him to move in a way that would make your life honorable and pleasing to Him. It begins with adoration. It begins with giving Him praise. It begins with telling Him that you know in your own life that He is Lord over all. It's amazing that the disciples went to Jesus and said, they did not say, teach us how to preach. They did not say, teach us how to teach. They did not say, teach us how to witness and evangelize. But they did say, teach us how to pray. I think they understood that everything that was powerful about Christ came from those times and those moments of prayer with His Father. They knew somehow those things were connected. And if we can learn how to pray in the garden alone with the Heavenly Father, then somehow that is what moves Him to preach. That is what moves Him to teach. That is what moves Him to heal. That is what moves Him to do. Everything that He's doing comes from that moment of prayer. Why? Because every time the Lord Jesus did something great, you can read of how He had just prayed. He had just spent time along with God. And what did Jesus say? He said, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name." He said, that's how you start your prayer time. Now listen, not those words, but the meaning behind them, that God's name is to be viewed as holy. It's to be reverenced. It's to be feared as above all and greater than all and all-powerful, that He is in charge and He is in control. And you go to Him to tell Him that, not because He doesn't know, but to let Him know that you know. And it's not just about the words. It's always about the heart. Lord, Your name is to be praised above everything. You are holy. You are just, and You will always be right. Bow before Him. Psalm 139, 23 through 24 says this: "Search me, God. Know my heart. Test me and know my concerns, and see if there's any offensive way in me. Lead me in the everlasting way." You want to get ready for Thanksgiving? You want to get ready to have a give praise with a thankful heart? You want to get ready for that this week? Then let God search your heart today. Let Him have His way in your life. Let Him show you the sin that you don't even realize is sin in your heart today. Let Him come into your life. Give Him the right to search out everything in your life and show you well, you are wrong. In a scene from Shadowlands, a film that's based on the life of C.S. Lewis, Lewis returned to Oxford from London, where he's just been married to Joy Gresham, an American woman, in a private Episcopal ceremony performed at her hospital bedside. She's dying of cancer, and through the struggle with her illness, she and Lewis have been discovering the depth of their love for each other. As Lewis arrives at the college where he teaches, he is met by Harry Harrington, an Episcopal priest, who asks what news there is. Lewis hesitates, and then deciding to speak of the marriage and not the cancer, he says, "Ah, good news, I think, Harry. Yes, good news." Harrington, not aware of the marriage and thinking that Lewis is referring to Joy's medical situation, replies, I know how hard you've been praying. Now, God is answering your prayer." "That's not why I pray, Harry," Lewis responds. "I pray because I can't help myself. I pray because I'm helpless. I pray because the need flows out of me all of the time, waking and sleeping. It doesn't change God. It changes me." When's the last time you spent time in prayer? When's the last time you spent just a quiet few moments going to God saying, God, this is my need. God, I'm stepping in the gap for someone else who's in need. Lord, we're not just going to talk about the hungry on Thanksgiving week and those without families, but we're going to pray for them. We're going to spend a few moments in prayer. When's the last time you've done that? When's the last time you got quiet before Holy God and just let Him speak to you? If it's been a while, then with Thanksgiving, do it today. Get your heart prepared for that wonderful day that we do spend together if we have family, that we do spend together if we have those around us who love us. Give thanks to Him this day. And get your heart ready for that day of Thanksgiving. When I pray, let me tell you a few things I'm thankful for. One, God listens. He hears every prayer I pray, even when He doesn't answer it the way I think He ought to. You ever have a prayer like that? Absolutely, we have. If you've ever prayed, you know that God doesn't always answer in the way that you would choose for Him to answer, but He hears. And the second thing I'm grateful for, that when I pray, not only does He hear, but He responds. And I'm thankful He doesn't respond in the way that I choose for Him to respond every time. I'm thankful that He is God and I am not, and He makes the choice of how He will work, but He does work. Sometimes with a yes, aren't you grateful for those moments, right? And just a quick yes, amen, Lord, thank you, praise be your holy name. Sometimes with a no. And sometimes that takes a few years, sometimes it takes a lifetime to look back and say, well, I'm thankful you did not answer my prayer the way that I prayed. And sometimes with a not now. The answer is yes, but it's going to be a while. The answer is yes, but it's going to take time. He responds. And listen, He reasons out in my life. Not only does He listen and respond, but He reasons out everything in my life that will be used for His honor and for His glory. And so He moves things out of the way. And that's what the Holy Spirit does through the Son when I pray. I pray through the Holy Spirit to the Son who whispers in the Father's ear my prayers. And here's how it works. I'll say, through the Holy Spirit, Lord, I want a new car. I want a new car, Lord. I know I need one. And so, Lord, I'm praying for a new car. And through the Son looks at the Father and whispers in His ear. He thinks he needs a new car, but the payment's too much and there's no way he can afford it. Don't give him a new car. Make the old one last a little bit longer. That's kind of an out there illustration, but you get the picture, right? The filter from your prayer to the ear of the Father is sometimes great. He reasons out in our lives those things that will be used for His honor and for His glory. Point number one, again, is do not worry. Point number two is do pray. And point number three, this is the last point, allow for transformation. Allow God to work. Allow God to move. The Bible says in verse 7, and the peace of God, which surpasses every thought, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. How do we not worry? Well, we go to God. We give it to Him. How do we not have anxiety and be divided in everything in our lives? We give it to Him and we say, Lord, we're going to trust You with thanksgiving in our hearts toward You. We're going to let You work in that situation. And whatever You choose to do, we're going to thank You for it. Now listen, it's easy to say amen to that until someone in your family seemingly is dying and you pray for them to be healed and God does not heal that person this side of heaven. It's a whole other ballgame when someone's life is on the line and you're praying and you pray for them to be healed and you're believing God for the healing and God does the healing on the other side of heaven. And when God chooses to do that, we as His people are not just called, but we are commanded to give thanks. To give Him glory. To give Him honor. Because He is always right. Now you can argue with Him if you want to. But the Creator over His creation generally wins the argument. And He'll do it gently. He'll do it very kindly. He'll give you all the time you need. You know, I'm kind of reminded of the great theologian Andy Griffith. Y'all remember him? You remember that one episode where where Opie's been told by one of his new little buddies that, you know, if you just throw a fit, I mean, just throw a fit, they get anything you want. And so he walks in there and he asks for some money, I think, and, you know, Andy doesn't give it to him, and he goes, Andy said, what are you doing? He said, I'm holding my breath. And he says, good exercise for the lungs, good exercise, Ope. Then the next thing he does, he falls down on the ground and he's kicking his arms and screaming. And Andy says, what are you doing now? He said, I'm throwing a fit. And he said, well, be careful. Don't dirty up your clothes. Sometimes that's how I feel before God. I feel like the Father's looking down saying, what are you doing now, Doug? Well, I'm throwing my fit because you didn't answer my prayer the way I wanted you to. Okay, well, be careful. Don't ruffle up your clothes, you know. I'm holding my breath until you answer the way I choose. Well, it's a good exercise for your lungs. It'll keep things pumping. I tell my boys all the time when they tell me I'm just mad. I tell them that's good for the heart. It keeps your blood pumping. Everybody will get mad from time to time. Then they're madder, right? Trust him. You can trust him. You can follow him. Allow him in the process of prayer to do the transformation on your heart. That's what he's about. He's a transforming God. What is he trying to do? He's trying to give us the peace of God that surpasses understanding and every thought and allow it to guard our hearts, to garrison our hearts, to advance, to mount a guard around, to hem in. That's what the word means. Our heart. He is a God of the heart. And he wants yours. Allow him to have it. Allow him to be the God that surrounds your heart in this moment. Whatever it is, whatever situation you're going through, if it's the loss of a family member, let him garrison, let him guard your heart. If it's the loss of a job or if it's the prospect of a new one, let him garrison your heart. Let him transform your heart. And when you allow him to do that, then the peace of God will overflow into your life. You'll have peace when you ought not have peace. That's what the Word of God means there. You'll be in a calm assurance when you should be running and screaming through the night. You'll not be like lost folks who do not know which way they are headed, but you'll be trusting in Him no matter what. Sad thing is, in the church, you can't tell much difference between the church and the lost and the way they respond to the situational life. We go through hard times and we're talking amongst one another. What are we going to do? I don't know what I'm going to do. I just don't know where I'm going to turn. I got a financial need and I don't know if I'm going to be able to make it. Well, the Word of God says that He will supply everything that you need, not according to your riches, but according to His. And He owns the cattle on 1,000 hills. And I've got great news. He owns the hills too. He has a bank account where there is no reserve. There is no end. He can continue to give to you just like he can to that one in Ethiopia. He can move in your life here in Arkansas just like he can to the one in Canada that's in great need. He has everything under control. Let him have it. Trust him. You can. He's trustworthy. Let me just say it in redneck English. He ain't never failed. And he won't start today. Now, I don't know what you're going through. You know, I was thinking about this sermon. I thought, you know, this sermon could just be for one person in this room today. But it's for somebody. I don't know what you're going through. Well, you just, man, you just, I don't know. I don't know. Don't have any answers. He knows. Let him be the answer. Let him be the answer, whatever the question is. Just fill in the blank with God. God will supply. I remember when we were having kids and you know, you got the first one. You don't really know what to do with that one, you know. And I remember having all kinds of questions, you know. Well, how are we going to afford this? Can we afford this? And you know, if you've had kids, if you're waiting until you can afford kids, well, you'll never have them. You never have them. I can even go back further than that. When we got married, I remember thinking, can I afford to do this? The answer is no. I couldn't afford to do it. I mean, if you just put it down on paper, it didn't work out. But God supplied all of our needs. We had kids. God supplied the need for the first one. God supplied the need for the second one. And God supplied the need for the third one. We had Sarah. We didn't have We had insurance, but it did not cover labor and delivery. And so, you know, we were concerned. That can get expensive. Alicia had a C-section. That's even more expensive than normal delivery. And so we were concerned with that. And I'm going to tell you, I worried myself to death about that. I really did. Because, you know, it's my job to provide. And so, I was worried. And so, we found a doctor that would let us kind of pay out, which most will. So we started paying out and, you know, all of this. And went to the hospital and checked with the hospital. And you know, can we, we can pay it out. And how much do you think it'll be? Somewhere between $5,000 and $12,000. I remember that number. I remember thinking, well, that's a pretty big gap. $5,000 to $12,000. I mean, we hope it's closer to five, but I had bad news. I didn't have five either, so I don't know what we do now. I remember the day she was born, Sarah was born, the lady came up and said, would you like to pay? I don't remember how much it was, but it was thousands of dollars today. I said, I'd love to. I can't, but I would love to pay you that money right now, but I can't. I mean, I can write you a check. Unless you need money, right? I can write you a check. And I remember all of that. You know what happened? There was an issue with the labor that caused our insurance to pay. And we got money back. See, I always knew if I could just have a girl, she'd pay for herself, right? I just say that because my two boys are right there. But honestly, that's what, and I remember it like it happened yesterday. I remember God saying, boy, I've taken care of everything so far. Why did you not think I could take care of this? There are times where the money doesn't get paid back. And I understand it sounds real easy to trust when it's everything goes well. But what happens, Brother Doug, when you still have to pay? He provides. I could give you testimony of how He has provided in my life. And He will provide in your life. That's rain. Y'all have heard it before, right? He will provide. He will always provide. For His people, He will always. That's heavy rain, in case you had ever heard that. I'm going to end with this illustration. During the war, a man died, and his two friends desperately wanted to give him a decent burial, so they found a cemetery in a nearby village, and it happened to be Roman Catholic. The man who had died was Protestant. When the two friends found the priest who was in charge of the burial grounds, they requested permission to bury their friend, but the priest refused because the man had not been a Catholic. When the priest saw their disappointment, he explained that they could bury their friend, but it would just have to be outside of the fence. That was what they did. Later, they returned to visit the grave, but they couldn't find it. They searched all around the cemetery, just outside the fence, and they couldn't find their friend. And so they went back, and they found this Catholic priest and said, "We can't find our friend's grave. It was just outside the fence." And the Catholic priest said this. He said, "After you left, I could see the concern for your friend, how much you loved your friend and this dead soldier who had served this nation. And I begin to think about having you bury him outside of the fence. And I begin to think of how wrong that was. And so I got with some men and we've moved the fence. He's now inside the cemetery. I want you to know, if you don't have another reason to give thanks, you can give thanks this Thanksgiving because our God moved the fence. He let you into the family. He gave you a relationship with Jesus Christ." Brother Roger mentioned it as he was praying that Jesus has died. What else do we need? He has paid our price, that we are saved, that we know Him in a relationship through Jesus Christ, that He is our Lord, that He is our Savior. And listen, if you're in this room and you say, "Well, He's not my Lord, He's not my Savior," then come meet this motley crew of misfits we have here at Westside. Come meet these folks who are sinners and now know a Savior. Come into the family. Let Him move the fence in your life. Let him be your Lord and your Savior in your life. And once that happens, then you can think on the things that are true. You can think on the things that are honorable. This is in verse 8. You can think on the things that are just and pure and lovely and commendable. And you can understand the moral excellence of thinking on these things. You can dwell on the good and not on the negative in your life. But it's only through Jesus that that's possible. And if you know Christ, you have a reason, not on Thursday, but today, to give thanks with a grateful heart. To give thanks to the Holy One. We sing about it. You have a reason to give thanks because of Jesus. You say, now, Brother Doug, you don't know what's going on in my life. Don't have to. If you know Jesus, you can give thanks. You don't know what it's like to lose loved ones. Yes, I do. Yes, I do. You don't know what it's like to go to Thanksgiving and not see that person there with the family. Yes, I do. It'll happen Thursday. Yes, I do. Thanks be unto God that on Thursday, when we meet, we'll meet at my grandmother's house. Used to be Grandma and Grandpa, but it's just Grandma now. But when we meet and I look around the table and at the end where he would be, he's not there. I know where he's at. He just got ahead of me. You know what he said? He said, if I get there before you do, I'll keep the gate kicked open for you, son. That's where he's at. He's at home with him. So I'm missing this Thursday, but I know where he's at. And give thanks for that today. If you know where your loved ones are, give thanks. They're at home in heaven. Let's bow for a moment of prayer. Brother Paul will come. We'll have an invitation. A little different sermon today. But I hope it's getting you ready for a great week of Thanksgiving. Oh, I hope you have plans with your family. I hope all of that will happen. You'll get to see folks that you haven't seen in quite some time. And I hope all that's going on for you this week. But I want you to know if it's not, I don't know if anybody else is praying for you, but I promise you I am. I promise you I'll pray for you this week. Be a tough week for you who have lost loved ones in this last year. If this is your first Thanksgiving without them, I know it's going to be hard. And so I want you to know, if nobody else is praying for you, I'll pray for you. There are others in this church who will pray for you as well. We love you. We hate you having to go through that, but everyone does. It's not easy. It's not fun. I know that. But we can give thanks to a holy God that he's in control. He's in control of life. He's in control of death. Not our job to figure it out. It's our job to trust in him. And you can trust him. Now, there are those in this room who next Thanksgiving, you may be the one someone misses. And if that's true, are you prepared to meet your God? You could be. If you trust in Jesus, if you've never trusted in the Lord Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, I'm going to ask you in this moment, will you just trust him? Right now, from your lips to his ears, will you just tell him, Lord Jesus, I believe. I give you my heart. I believe that you died for me on a cross, and I believe that you arose from the dead. And just tell him, as we all do, we can't fully explain all of that, but we believe it by faith. Be sure if you prayed those words, meant it with all of your heart, to thank him for saving you. Now, in just a moment, we'll have an invitation, and we'll encourage you, if you have just prayed that prayer, to come. Let the world know that you have been saved. There'll never be an easier moment to tell the world that you've been saved than right now where you are. You're surrounded by people who will love you and celebrate your salvation with you. Come, let us know. Father, we love you. We praise you. Father, thank you for the altar today. And Lord, if you're moving in someone's heart to come and kneel in it, Father, I pray that they would. Not for me or for this church, but for you and for your honor and for your glory. Father, we thank you for this place that we're meeting in today, and the people of it. And Father, if there's someone who's just received Jesus, Father, I pray that they'd let us know. so we can celebrate with them. Father, there may be others who have questions about a relationship with Christ. Father, I pray they'd come as well. Lord, you move during this invitation for your honor and for your glory. Father, help us to decide what we will do with what you have said in this place. Lord, for the one in this room who has anxiety, who struggles, Lord, just to trust you. Lord, I think we can all say we've been there. But Lord, there are some who struggle more than others. And Father, I pray that in this moment that they would have the peace that passes all understanding, that you are in charge. And Father, that your love would garrison, would guard, would hem in their heart today. Lord, let them know you're there. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's all stand. If you need to come, you come as we sing.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How ashamed, I hear my mocking voice. offers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished.
Amen. Amen. We're so honored that you came to worship with us today. If you are a guest, again, we hope you felt at home. Hope you'll come back and worship with us very, very soon. We'll have discipleship study tonight. We meet in the sanctuary first at 6, and then we break up into our groups. Brother Roger is leading the church through the book of Acts, and I'm doing discipleship 101 back in my Sunday school class across the hallway. Brother Roger's group stays in here. Brother Paul goes downstairs with the teenagers. He's teaching through the fundamentals of the faith with them. And the kids go back in the back for children's choir. And if I missed a group, I'm sorry. But we do discipleship on Sunday nights for just a little while. And then we'll go back to our regular Sunday night worship services very, very soon. Again, nothing this week on Wednesday, so don't forget that. You can come, but none of the rest of us will be here, all right? So nothing on Wednesday. And I hope, if I'm the first one to say this to you, I hope you do have a very, very happy Thanksgiving. Yes, ma'am. Yeah, the food bank will be open Wednesday, and our group is manning on Wednesday, and so need help for that. So don't forget about that. As I said before, you've got Miss Brooke and Miss Christy who are here, and if you want to help, let them know. All right, we're praying for you as you'll be on the road, some of you this week, and some of you have family who are coming in. So let's just go to the Lord in prayer for all of those needs. Father, once again, we just love you. We praise you. We thank you so much for your Son, Jesus. We give him praise, honor, and glory today for what he's done for us. Father, if we don't have another reason to give you thanks, we can thank you for Jesus. And Father, this week, as will many of us in this room, will be traveling. Father, I pray for traveling grace and travel mercy, Lord. There will be those who will be coming in to family, Lord. Be with them as well as they travel in. Father, we pray that we would give you thanks, not just this week, but every day of our lives. And it's in the precious name of Jesus we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Amen.